Hello, I'm Dave Whitehouse, a solutions architect with Data IQ. Data IQ is the leading enterprise Kubernetes platform for running Kubernetes workloads at scale. Everything you need for easy adoption and to enable advanced workloads across any infrastructure, whether that's on-prem, in the public cloud, air-gapped environments, or even at the edge. Today, I'm going to give you a short demonstration of how to deploy a fairly vanilla open source Kubernetes cluster into a highly restricted or air-gapped environment using kubeadm, which is a Kubernetes native cluster creation tool that conforms to best practices. There's many reasons why you'd wish to deploy air-gapped, including data privacy, or perhaps even you're a government organization working with classified or highly sensitive information. Now, there's many existing tools in the Kubernetes ecosystem that allow you to deploy with relative ease, albeit into a public cloud or on-premises, connected environment, or even a laptop. But standing up a cluster behind the wire without access to the internet makes this relatively trivial task way more complex. By means of a simple demo, we're going to set up a basic cluster consisting of a single control plane and a single worker node, running Ubuntu as the base operating system. There's a number of steps to go through in order to achieve this. First of all, we're going to stand up that environment. Then we're going to gather various packages and dependencies. Following that, we'll gather some deployment images that we need, and we're going to build an air-gap bundle. Once that's built, we'll prepare our hosts and transfer that bundle onto each of the nodes. We'll then stand up our control plane, and finally, we'll install into our nodes, which will run our workloads. So let's get started then. We'll move into the terminal. I've created my control plane and my node, and I've put an entry in /etc/hosts, so I don't have to remember the IP addresses, which are 10.0.0.131 and 132 respectively. And there they are. So I'm in my home directory. I'm now going to make a new directory called air-gapped, and I'm going to cd into that. And I'm going to make three further subdirectories. First one for Debian packages, the second one for Docker images, and the third one is for our CNI manifest. And that's complete. So let's start with our Debian packages first. We'll go back up into the that directory. So I've pasted into there essentially an array of the packages that I think I'm going to need. And now I'm going to simply iterate through that array of packages. And for each one of those, I am going to do a sudo apt install. But instead of installing it, I'm going to set the download only flag, the reinstall flag, so that if I've already got the package, it will be, we'll go and fetch that again. And we're going to iterate through each of those. So what we're doing now is we've given a base list of packages. And we're going through, we're iterating through those, and where that package has dependencies, hopefully we're pulling them, and we're going to save it to that /deb directory. We'll give that a few seconds to complete. And good, that works. So you can see there, if I list them out, and we've got all the Debian packages we needed. Okay, let's go and get our Docker images. So again, very similarly, we'll go into that subdirectory and we'll set an array of the images that I know we'll need. Let's just copy and paste those for ease. And there they are. And again, we're going to run a very similar operation here. We're going to iterate through through each of those. And for each one, we are going to pull the Docker image, and we are going to save it to disk, hopefully in this subdirectory. So a little bit of bash scripting there. You don't necessarily have to follow this path. You can run a Docker pull command for each of those images if you wish. But for speed and ease, I'm just going to write this simple looping statement that will go and do that for me. I'm going to change the file name slightly. Okay. Okay, so all we're doing there is we're just putting a statement in to generate a file name to remove illegal characters, and we'll push that out to that file name as a tar file. Oh, right, what's going on? Okay. Ah, right, okay, I see. Oh, we've got a double quote there. Okay, all right, let's give that a go. Good. So this might take a little bit longer in your instance. I've already got these images pulled onto the machine. So this should only really take a few seconds to complete. And it is now completed. So let's list those out. And you can see there that we've got a list of compressed images that we're going to add to our bundle. Okay then, the final step is that we are going to go back up a level, and we're going to go into our networking directory that we've created. And we're simply going to pull a manifest file here from GitHub for our Calico CNI. CNI is a container network interface, and we need to apply that once we've got the cluster stood up so the networking works. Okay, so we've got the three of our individual elements that we've got that we need now, and we're simply going to wrap those up in a tarball. We're going to call that airgap bundle. We're going to define what we want to put into that bundle before we button it up. So we're going to take all of the images, all of the packages, and that networking manifest, and the tar command is there compressing that and building our bundle for us. This again should just take a few seconds. Then we should end up with a bundle that's approximately 0.5 gig in size. Once that's complete, clearly we need to transfer that onto each of our nodes. So we've created our bundle and we've tarred it up. The next step then is to transfer it onto each of the nodes. So I'm going to use the scp command. You may or may not have SSH type access to those nodes, it being an air-gapped environment, in which case you would want to use some type of magnetic media perhaps to transfer it. And that's transferred to the /tmp directory on the control plane. Let's do the same for node 1. And it looks like that was successful. Okay, next we want to go and reconfigure. So let's get a shell on each of those nodes, the control plane and node 1. I'm lucky enough to have a terminal software that will broadcast to both of those instances, so that I only have to set up each node once, type once. So we are in the home directory. Let's make another air gap directory there, and let's go into that. Next thing we're going to do is move that air gap bundle out of the /tmp directory into our local directory, and then we're going to inflate it using the tar command. Okay, that's running. That should be decompressing all of our air gap bundle there. And what we should see, and we do, is a list of those subdirectories that have been recreated on the nodes. Okay, next, let's get into the DB directory and let's install those Debian packages. And there they are. So to do this, I'm just going to run a dpackage install command, and I'm going to use the wildcard, so it's going to just install everything with a /deb extension. And hopefully that will be successful and we won't get any complaints of dependencies missing. Okay, we need escalated privileges for that, so I'll put in my password. And we're untarring the bundle. So next thing I'm going to do is add my local user to the Docker group. This will allow me to use Docker as a local user rather than root. And when we conduct an operation like that, don't forget that you need to log out of that shell and then back in again for that change to take effect. So we'll do that now. So we are going to get a session on both the node and the control plane. And similarly, we're going to set up multiplexing or broadcast input there so that we can type on both machines. And we're going to run a quick docker ps command, which shows us that we are privileged to conduct docker operations as a local user. Okay, we've got some more configuration steps to set up both of our nodes. And the first thing we've got to do is disable swap. So let's go and run a swap off command now. Okay. And we clearly need sudo to do that. So let's put in a password. Next thing we need to do is make that change persist. And so what you might need to do is go in and change your /etc/fstab file so that if the machine reboots, you won't automatically set up swap. So you can either go and manually change that. Here I'm just going to run a clever sed command or a stream editor command, which will go and do that for me. It will go into the file and remove that line for me so that swap remains off. Next thing we're going to do is disable SE Linux, which was successful. And then we're going to allow IPv4 forwarding by setting /proc/sys/nets, that's IPv4, /IP forwarding to the value of 1. Okay, well, somehow we've got a permission denied. Let's just check that anyway, because I suspect that it's already in that state. So if we just look at the state of that file, let's just cat that file out and make sure that it's 1 rather than 0. Okay, good. Right, so we're ready to go with IP forwarding. Next step is we're going to remove the /etc/containerd configuration. We don't need that and it can cause some confusion. So let's just remove that completely. Containerd being our container runtime. And then in order to put those changes into effect, we are going to restart the containerd service, which we've done and looks to have been successful. Good. Okay, I'm going to turn off multiplexing here because I just want to operate simply on the control plane here. And you can see that I've run a simple command. It's the kubeadm command, the init command, which will start to install our Kubernetes onto the control plane and start to build a control plane. Okay, next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get the kubeconf file, which essentially is our private key and gives us access to our cluster. So you see there, I've made in my home directory a directory called .kube, and I've simply taken that file from /etc/kubernetes/admin.conf and copied it into the .kube/config. And I've got a permissions issue, so let me just take ownership of that particular file. And this is the default place it's stored. So when you use kubectl to issue commands to the cluster, this is where it's going to look for that private key and details of the cluster. And if I run the kubectl command there, I can see that I've got a number of pods. Most of them are running and some of them are in a pending state. So good. We've got the beginnings of a Kubernetes cluster. The control plane is up. It's just provisioning a few pods there. So let's turn our attention back to the kubeadmin join token. You see I've just copied and pasted it there. I'm going to move across. First of all, I think what we'll do is we'll apply the networking CNI. So we've got a manifest there in the networking folder for Calico. So that's a simple declarative YAML. And I'm going to use a kubectl apply command and apply that. That should set up our networking and allow the pods to communicate with each other. So let's now take another look at the state of our pods. And you can see that we've deployed Calico, but it's still pending and still deploying. Okay, so let's copy that join token into node 1. Need to run that as sudo. And we're starting to deploy kubelet and the rest of the components that we're going to need for Kubernetes on node 1. And hopefully that token will simply, once we've run it, will allow node 1 to find the control plane and join the cluster. Okay, and that's been a success. So now what we should assume is that we've got a, if we do a kubectl get nodes, we should see both of the nodes in a healthy state. So let's go back over to the control plane. Let's come out of that watch command and let's take a look at our nodes. Okay, so we can see that our control plane is ready. Node 1 is still joining. Let's take another quick look at the containers, see how they're doing. Okay, that's all looking good. Let's take another final look at the nodes, hopefully. And there we go. Okay, so what you see there is that we've got a two-node cluster, one control plane, and one worker node. And if I look at the Kubernetes objects there, you can see that everything's healthy and up and running. So that's the easy part done, and we've now got a running cluster. Just to recap what we've done, we've stood up our environment with two nodes. We gathered our packages and dependencies. We also gathered up the container images that we require, and we built an air-gap bundle. We transferred that bundle to our host, and we did some prep work on those. And then we installed the control plane. Once that was successful, we installed our nodes, and that's going to eventually run our workloads. We should, however, be under no illusion that this cluster is production ready, as we've still got a lot of things to configure, not least security, storage, observability, and perhaps a service mesh. If you'd rather save yourself the hassle and complexity of doing that, we'd love to chat to you, regardless of where you are in your Kubernetes journey, whether you're right at the start, or perhaps you wish to significantly cut down operating costs, escape vendor lock-in, or run machine learning workloads on a secure enterprise Kubernetes estate in hours, not months. If so, please do visit us at d2iq.com. Thanks for watching.